I'm here today to share my experience concerning the usage of WSO2 governance registry for some governance purposes at our customers. You will be faced a few things you have seen in the morning session today from another perspective, because all these things which were presented there, we experienced ourselves and worked on some solution around that. As you heard, I'm working for MSG Systems, a German consulting company. I'm working for a group called Applied Technology Research, so looking for new products, new technologies, and methodologies, and check how they fit to the needs of our customers, and then support our projects to bring them up and running. So my special topic is integration, so all the stuff around enterprise application integration, service-oriented architecture, API management today. So trying something new is always a bit like a journey. So usually you know where you start from, usually you know where you want to go. You know the waypoints you will meet on your way, but usually you don't know which challenges you will be faced on your way. So I will tell you something about our journey. So our aim was to do some governance of services and all the artifacts around with governance registry. And there were a few waypoints. I will share our experience we made with them. So we had to have a meta model, have a capability to access that meta model for somehow API, and at the end, using an API which allows us to manage that meta model for our customers. So looking at the first one, the starting point brings me to the question, where do we come from? So I'm working for a large automotive customer for years, and over the last decades, a lot of systems have been built, supporting all these processes from development, production, procurement, and sales. And over the years, they become more and more integrated, so a lot of interfaces and dependencies were built up between those systems. So the need for some governance on that came up. So it was about 10 years ago, and decided to set up some governance platform to manage all these dependencies. So we employed the SOA approach with all its principles to set up some guidelines, some rule sets, how to manage interfaces, how to build them, how to create them, set up some processes to control that, and build some tooling around that to support the design time governance on one hand and the runtime governance on the other hand. So after, it was, I think, 4 or 5 years ago, so we end up with some standardization based on some web service, especially for communication between application clusters in a company, within a company, and between those application clusters and systems of the customers, like dealer systems, importer systems, and what you have in the automotive area. So we established a landscape comprising some commercial tools for runtime governance. So the web service gateways and ESB functionality we employed by IBM products like IBM Data Power. And on the other hand, for the all design time governance, we had some homegrown set of tools. We built ourselves and support that or manage that those processes. So you may say, what's the problem with that? If it works fine, it's good. So it was really there were some issues with that. So one of them was it was built over the time, used different technologies, some Java, some Perl here, some XML transformation, whatever. It was a mixture of some things. So it was hard to maintain. On the other hand, the different artifacts you have to manage, a few of them have to be in SVN, source control system. Others have been in some Excel files. So we have some enterprise architecture tool running, planning IT, having some assets like domains and stuff. Yeah, and all that things are somehow related with each other. So we had set up subscripting and process, which creates some websites for discovery and feed the enterprise service bus those gateways with some configuration data. And so some issues, there are no real-time discovery was possible because of that generation process in between. And at the end, new requirements came up, and we want to not only manage SOAP web services, but also REST APIs. So we decided not to proceed with that governance tooling. So we defined, put our vision on the map and said, how such a governance platform for design time governance should look like for us. So one thing we wanted to have everything at one place, so a centralized governance platform, so which allows us to manage or to store all our artifacts, which are which we have to manage. We wanted to have some lifecycle management on that, so controlling the state of those artifacts which are in focus. Therefore, we needed some role and right management to support the different roles in that life cycle and even different roles of for customers who deal with the services, those who manage that and those who are only do discovery and looking for something. And as a company working for has a lot of subsidiaries, there was a requirement for some tenant awareness, so because we want to set up some federated governance, so following the same principles and rules, but separated responsibility. So we needed some tenant awareness. Yeah, from user perspective, we have some similar as we've seen this morning in mind. Two different kind of clients: those who manage things, and those are use discovery, search for services, and so we have some governance client and some discovery client in mind. On the other hand, from a technological point of view, we wanted to have some web browser-based application which can be used on different devices. On the other hand, the platform is not standalone, as we have some data sources, as we have just seen in the presentation before. Maybe there are enterprise architecture systems at our side, planning IT, so we have to feed things in. On the other hand, we have to feed something out, because we want to feed the enterprise service bus, so our gateways, with data. So there's a need for some APIs. Which allows us to do that. So that was a vision we started with. So we looked around for some platform which supports us doing that. The first approach was looking at IBM, because IBM staff was in the company. The gateways, the web service gateways we used were from IBM, and other tools either. So the tool targeted that problem was is IBM WebSphere Registry and Repository. So we looked at that. It's really a very powerful tool. So it allows you to define your own meta model based on an ontology. It comes with strong support for all these XML stuff, whistles, XSDs, and whatever, analyzing them and putting from the right to the left and whatever you want to do. It comes with generic client, but the problem is, as it is with the governance registry, it's a generic one, very generic. So it's no client you can give any end user to work with. We did some investigation on that and decided, okay, that's not the approach we're looking for. Then we looked around for some alternatives. So a colleague of mine, he saw some presentation on WSO2. It was about 1 year ago. Never heard before WSO2. Yes, I'd say it's, it's on one hand it's open source, on the other hand, it seems to be easy to use. So we said, okay, give it a try, let's have a look on that. So we saw there's even strong capability to making to building some custom meta model, the lifecycle stuff. There were some APIs you can deploy, so it looks fine for us, and say, okay, let's try that. So the first thing to achieve was, okay, the meta model. So if you if you know a little bit of the governance to registry, there's some mechanism that just that is called RXTs. So you can define your own asset types. Yeah, it's an XML definition of that, and it has you have a capability to define all the attributes you want, and you can define. You can define relationships between those assets. So first of all, because the governance registry aimed to manage services, so we said, okay, it's just what we want to do, so maybe the meta model fits. So, but it didn't fit, so it has, it's quite more easy than ours is. Yeah. It has services, endpoints, and deals with some definitions like whistles and XML schema, but it was not what we have, because we had a meta model in our old tooling. We want to have all the artifacts managed there, get them into the governance registry. So some special thing we have managed types. So we have a type system used over different services. Like the business objects, it's a reuse of business objects. Another thing, we have the code list of codes which are used widely in business objects and services. Then a third thing is, so we have a special concept of WSTL. It's called all-in-one. So when we deploy some service specification, we put it in one file. So all the XSD schema are included in a WSTL. And even that's not supported by governance registry as it works. Yeah, if you try to pass that, it will fail. So there are a few things that let us realize that okay, we have to build our own meta model. As it looks like you see here. So we employed these mechanism which allows us to build our own model. The first thing you have to consider is storage location. So you may ask, okay, you define a meta model, and why do you think about storage location? Yeah, it's really behind because in the under the hood, all the artifacts are stored on the resource base. So every artifact, if you define a service artifact type, and if you create a service, it will create a resource file containing all the attributes you have defined in your XT. So, and because of that resource model, there is the unique key of the in the resource area is the storage path. So you have to ensure that you that it is unique. So, so first of all, we looked on the how WSO2 did it with their own meta model. So we saw, they use flat structures. So have one asset type, for instance, endpoint, and all the endpoints are below in that collection. The problem with that for us was because we have a lot of services and business objects, and we have even business objects and services having the same name sitting in different domains. So putting all them into one pot would lead to conflicts. On the other hand, we have structures like that. So we have a service concept, then we have some specification. So one service can have different specification in different revisions and issues. Those are described by some technical or technical description and documentation. And we really wanted to store stuff at one place. For right management, for instance, setting putting the changing in during the life cycle, changing the writes, the access writes from write to read only on one node, and have everything affect that Denise. So the issue with that was, yet it is not possible to define an asset type which is a collection. Yeah, if you want to be that one, an asset, and say, okay, but we want, in a structured Denise, we want to have some other documents, it's not possible. So we had to think about on how to deal with that. So we came up with a structure you see here. You set up a collection for each artifact which contains other assets, and if it is an asset itself, putting in an asset file with the same name as the as a collection with the suffix meta. So that's a real asset which describes the service spec. And all the others are other definitions. So that was one. So after we did that. Another question was, as you've seen in the meta model, we have a lot of relations. Yeah, we have assets and we have relations between of them. So there's a mechanism in the RxT to define relations. Yeah, so you do that in the XML. you have different kinds of relations, one-to-one, one-to-many, uni or bidirect, both directions. So we decided to to do bidirectional, yeah, defining an association always on one side. So for instance, if you have a service specification here and you associate it to the service version, you define your relation here, and you have two roles. Yeah, one relation, one direction is okay. The service for that, yeah, is that one, and if you look the other way around, the specification of that is that one. So that's what we defined. So under the hood, these relations are mapped to associations on the resource model. So and then we realized, oh. It really depends if we update that or that at last, the associations one an association will disappear and come back again, and so we stuck with that and did not know what is the reason for that. So we really dived deep in the source code and went through the source code, and then came up with in the source code which does the mapping of the relations to the associations. A special case we had here was not discovered. So that one, that you have relations associations with the same name defined in different places. So what we had here defined an association a relation that said, okay, our service is that. And we had defined a relation here. We said, okay, this is a domain for that service, and from the domain perspective, that's the service. So they have both the same name, and it failed with that one. So after we have discovered that, so we changed our meta model. It was not really a problem, but it took us some time to realize that. After those issues and a few more, we were able to define our meta model. It worked in general. It worked fine. We have about 13 assets, different asset types, with about 30 different relations. There are those assets which have attributes. Yeah, we have those. We have assets that don't have attributes. Yeah, so that's like the whistle or XML schema definition or some documentation. And then we were quite fine with that. The next question was, okay, how to deal with that meta model. So we wrote some migration from our platform we have today using that populator. Yeah, the populator, so using the web services which are there, you can populate data in. We did that. And then the question was, okay, how to deal with the assets, how to manage them, how to manage the life cycle. So the governance registry comes with the generic manager client, so you can do all that stuff, but it's not really what you want to give to your end user. Yeah. So the thing was, okay, the alternative is to build your own UI, and the question behind is there any governance API you can use? So, you can click, can you click in? Okay. So we started mid of last year, so the actual version was 4.6. Yeah, and looked at the APIs where, which were available. So there was a web service one just mentioned in the presentation before. Yeah, it covers quite all, everything you can do. The problem with that, it is really hard to employ from a web, web client perspective. Yeah? So it was no real issue, no real solution for us. So on the other hand, there is a REST API. So that's what that's the thing we was looking for. But it yeah, it was on it was not on governance level because it's on resource level. Yeah, you can do all the collection stuff and create resources and all that. But yeah, you are not on the on the governance level with that. It was about mid of last year we saw there was a new product which was called Enterprise Store. Not sure if it still exists. I think it's went into the governance center now. I don't know. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we have seen that and say, okay, they have some special, some custom UI in there. So maybe there must be some API you can use. So we looked into it and say, okay, yeah, there is one. It's based on some JavaScript coding on the server side using jQuery framework and host objects. But it was not real documented, so it's not real issue for not real alternative for us. So let's finally, yeah, we came up with a decision. Say, okay, let's build our own API. So API, so mean REST API to be used by an external client. So we set up some requirements, functional ones and some non-functional ones. Yeah. So one aim was to have, yeah, it should be generic. So independent of what kind of asset you define, you should use it everywhere. It should allow a complete handling on the governance level. Yeah, so you, the, on the governance level, you have UUIDs. You have IDs from your, of your assets which you deal with. And if you want to change a command of that one, so it would be our, we wanted to use that ID and say, okay, here's the command for that. we have also binary assets. Yeah, how to, we have to deal with that, yeah, which have no attributes. There's no, nothing to manage. You can only download them, update them, and upload them. Yeah, some validation support we wanted. Yeah, we had some we had something in mind how our client should work. That it will deal. It deals with asset and yeah, it deals with all the relations of those assets. So yeah, we had some optimization in mind. Say, okay, if we yeah, if we acquire some assets, we want to get also the relations to that on the asset on the governance level. So just browse the relations then. Yeah, asset retrieval. Okay, we have heard some Solr-based retrieval, which is about indexing, and yeah, alternatively, yeah, just retrieve assets from the data model. Yeah, the lifecycle stuff was one of ours. We want we want to have a client which shows all the which shows the lifecycle as it is. It should show what are the opportunities for a current user, what are the history data. So have some can assess those stuff from that governance level. And we also saw some need for some special APIs. Yeah, because if you have some web service, maybe you want to do some parsing on that and showing the operations or whatever. That the functional ones, On the non-functional side, you will would like to have some paging and sorting and all that stuff on all the attributes we you define in your asset. And another thing was authentication. So we had tried a little, we had worked a little bit with checked, did some investigation on the API gateway and the identity server and all that stuff, and saw all the different kinds of authentication mechanisms are used there. And I said, okay, our client, our API should support that. So the basic one, just username, password here. If you work with an API gateway, the communication here will be using a JSON web token, transferring the user identity and roles and whatever to here, so it should be able to discover that. If you use some OAuth services like an identity server, you may have that situation where you get a token here and you have to validate it from here. And yeah, at our customer, they have something like WebSeal using doing all the authentication, and yeah, it's dealing here with an EV user token. So our client should be finally configurable to support all these different kinds of authentication authentication headers here. Yeah, so that was that was our aim. And what we did, we built an API. Don't want to go through that one. It's just a structure. What I want to say is, okay, it's a resource view. We have the thing is assets. On assets, you can do search and retrieval. And then you have that asset, you can do everything. You have always that ID inside here, and you have the option to deal with binary stuff. So you have to know if an asset is a binary one, and if you do that and say, okay, binary, then you get the binary data of that. You have a lifecycle stuff. Also with the asset type and ID, you have a tag stuff and the command stuff, everything working on the same level. Yeah, so we did that. It was end of last year, we were fine with that. So governance registry came up and say, oh, great, something changed. Oh yeah, so they have a governance API. Oh, fine, on REST base. Great, so it's just what we looked for and what we did ourselves. The question was, okay, does it do everything what we want? Not really. So there are a few issues with that. One is, it's no association support. You know, if you want to deal with associations, you have to switch to another API, to the other resource-based REST API and do that association stuff. You have to leave your governance level. There's no validation support. There is some validation support, but not prior. You cannot say, okay, is that asset valid before you try to update this or insert it? No support for binary asset. The lifecycle configuration data, it's not there. You have also go to the resource REST API. It only supports solar-based retrieval assets. It's usually what you want, but there are some situations where you really want to retrieve what's in the database and not what's indexed. Yeah. So we had those issues. And there's also only OS2 support, a basic OS support, and not all the other. So yeah, at the conclusion, we were fine with that. So we use our own API. The thing to achieve was to build some user-friendly single-page application, stateless one, for the client purposes. So we had some experience on that before concerning the technology. So we did things using Bootstrap and AngularJS and with D3 data visualization and that. Like, okay, that's the stuff we want to employ. There's also some rules on a company that said, okay, we have some book of standards. We want you, if you build a web application using those technologies. Yeah, so see those here. and so we decided, okay, using that one, those technologies, and build our client. There's a mechanism, so who knows you, if you know AngularJS, there's a method of to define some standard behavior. You can build those directives, which allows you to reuse standard capabilities. So those we identified was at asset lifecycle management. Yeah, everywhere where you have a lifecycle, you have some special requirements. It's a relations network, so all the association stuff. you have assets, so has associations with other assets. They are typed. It's a generic one. You need everywhere. And there are some special things which are called tree maps. So it's like tree-like structures, like a domain structure. You have a domain and a subdomain. So it's a tree-like structure, and you expect some special kind of navigation on that. So there's a thing we had in mind when we did some directives. So here's it shows you the directive we made for for lifecycle management. It's a generic one, so it does auto-routing on your definition of the lifecycle, shows you all your states and all your transitions. It supports transition dialogue. So if you click on one of those transition, it will give you some advice what will happen. And if there are some parameters needed for that transition, for the executors, for instance, that you can put them then there. And if the transition is done, you will get some response. You will get a response not only on the case of fail, but you will also get a positive response. So you can write some information in your executors, which will be shown here at the end. The other thing is a history, so you can check that history thing and see what is done on the life cycle before. All that is a generic one. It's just one line of HTML at the end, where you give your asset type and asset ID and the life cycle name, and it will show you that. Another directive is a network one. So we have seen that it's a generic thing. You have different kind. I have that directive concerning the asset relations. Allows some different layouts, pinning some things and browsing. Do some search on all the governance registry and expand relations from there. Use some filtering and filtering here and show some metadata on the assets. That directive is, and the third one we made is a tree map like. So you have a zoomable tree map. You go in here and say it's especially used for those domain stuff, and you can dive in by clicking here and going into the structure. So let me come to the conclusion. At the back you can see one of our user interfaces. If you're interested in that, I can show you after one. A conclusion. It was a right platform to choose the WSO2. So it cost us some effort to realize all these things we wanted to have, but at the end it was a right decision. And as we have seen this morning, that there are a lot of things are done in between, going in a similar direction as we did. So thank you for your attending.